Hi everyone, welcome to Yodo One's virtual room. My name is Joseph, and I am the Business Development Manager for KT Play, Yodo One's community management tool. In this presentation, we'll be covering why is community important to you. Then we will share some tips on how you could best set up your own community. And last but not least, we'll be discussing how you should be leveraging the community data to obtain meaningful insights and improve your game's performances. If you have any questions during the course of this presentation, do post them in the public chat. We'll be there to answer your questions. So, why is community important? There are many different reasons why community is essential for your game, but today I will summarize them in three key pointers. First one being, it helps you to gain more users. A well-run community could definitely help you gain more users. As we all know, UA is increasingly high, and to combat the rising costs, we should explore other options to gain new users. And one of the best ways to do it is to use word of mouth marketing by leveraging the very people who are playing your game, the fans. Let's take Radio Stampede, one of our own games, as an example. What Radio Stampede has done is to leverage on their in-game community and encourage all their players to join an event. This is an event where they are tasked to share gameplay footages onto TikTok, and based on how well received they have created that gameplay content to be is on TikTok, we will give out prizes such as Nintendo Switch, in-game currency, or game merchandises. All in all, we spend an estimated $6,000 for this event. The results, by the end of the event, we've actually managed to gather more than 1,500 new videos generated, over 21 million video views on TikTok, and most importantly, almost double the number of organic users playing Radio Stampede during this period of time. What this means is that we have spent a grand total of $6,000 to obtain tens of thousands of new users to play Radio Stampede. In fact, although this event occurred a while back, players are still generating content on TikTok. The last time I checked, we have gathered more than 120 million views on TikTok. Therefore, building a community for your game is important because it gives you a platform where you could leverage your players to do word of mouth marketing. Second factor why community is important for your game is because it increases retention rates. In any well-run community, there are bound to be veterans that will be willing to help the newbies along. We use this to our benefit and to improve our first-time user experience for our own game, Transformers Earth War. This is a screenshot of Transformers Earth War. As you can tell, it is a strategy game where first-time user experience is a crucial aspect that determines how successful the game will be. On top of designing a first-time user experience where players could gradually learn the ropes, we've also decided to leverage on the player guides found within our community to guide our new users along. As you can see in the screenshot, players are able to easily access a collection of guides all within the game. Just by doing so, we have noticed a 5% increase in day one retention for Transformers Earth Wars. By building a community, we provide players with a platform to not only socialize, but also to discuss and share their knowledge with other gamers. This has helped us when it comes to first-time user experience, and also to generate more interest in the game as they learn new tips and tricks. The third reason why community is important is because you can directly interact with the players and gather their feedback. Feedback from your players is crucial no matter if it's a newly launched game or a matured one. In fact, I'm going to give you another example that has happened in Transformers Earth Wars. So, in our game, we organize weekly events to keep our players engaged. So in March last year, we launched a new event that's designed for our players to enjoy themselves. Sadly, we were not performing up to our standard for that particular event. For other events that we organize, we consistently see a participation rate of roughly 65%. However, for this new event, we are only seeing a 58% engagement rate, which is a much lower engagement rate compared to the rest. So, instead of us trying to think of different ideas that could potentially resolve this issue, we have decided to leverage on our community and to ask them what could we do to improve. We have gathered thousands of feedbacks from our gamers, with many of them actually taking the time and effort to write detailed suggestions on how we could improve. Armed with this feedback, we have actually managed to make the necessary adjustments and increase our event engagement rate by 8% since. At the end of the day, the gamers are your customers. You'll want to create a game that is well received by them. So what better way to do so than to collect their direct feedback? So to quickly summarize, community is important because A, it helps you to get new users at a fraction of a cost, B, it helps you retain existing users that's in your game, and C, it gives you a better understanding of your gamers. However, I would like to emphasize that building a community is not as easy as you may think it is. It's not just about creating an account. In fact, you're almost bound to fail if you don't take the time to plan early. Just like anything else, a successful community requires conscientious effort. So with that in mind, I thought I would share some tips on when you're setting up your own community so that you could have a successful one. The first question you need to ask yourself before you even do anything else is, what does success look like to you? Are you building a community to gather feedback from your players? Are you hoping that your community content will go viral and get loads of downloads? Or are you creating a community so that you have a place to share updates and new events that are happening within the game and with your studio? I understand all of these factors are all attractive, but here's the thing. Different goals will require slightly different methods to achieve them, and we all have limited resources. What I would recommend you is that you first decide on what is most important and place your focus on it. If you have additional time and resources to do it, we could do something else as well. Tip number two, how do you choose what platform to use? Choosing a platform is a very subjective thing, and there are many different factors that will affect your final decision. Thus, I will be sharing some guiding questions that you should be asking yourself, and you can come up with your final decision on your own. First question you should be thinking is, where does your players actually hang out? An important rule of thumb for community management is to be where your audience is already at. If you ask your players to join a platform they are not familiar with, you'll probably be managing a very empty community. So, you can understand where your players hang out by analyzing your game's profile and comparing them with different platforms' demographics. So, for example, if my game is mainly made up of 13 to 17 years old, I'll probably be looking at YouTube instead of Facebook, as not many teens are on Facebook these days. Another question you need to ask yourself is, what kind of engagement do you want to have with your players? What kind of medium will be most suitable for you? So if I'm looking to gather feedback for my game, my previous option of YouTube might not be the best. it's not the best place to collect feedback. Perhaps I would need to go for a platform like Reddit, where it's much easier to have a conversation with my gamers and to understand how they feel. Another thing that you need to consider is that, do you have the time and budget to maintain the community? Different platforms have different commitments. Even if it engages the correct target audience in the correct medium, you may not have the resources to maintain it. Finally, regardless of what platform you potentially choose to use, do yourself a favor and get an account the moment you decide on the IP of the game. It will save you a lot of trouble down the road, especially if someone else did take the Instagram handle that you wanted. So, after deciding on what platform you use, you need to plan on how you're going to engage your players. So when you're planning, I would strongly urge you to consider the human psychology. In fact, if you play your cards right, this would be the most important thing, and your gamers would love to be a part of it, and even give back more than you expect. So, the first thing that you need to realize is that humans love free stuff. They could provide free stuff to give incentive. So this is exactly what one of our partners did, LBC Studios. They leveraged on their in-game community to encourage players to go to their social media platforms and leave a comment in there. People do it, receive a prize, free gift. Through this event, they've managed to double their Twitter and Facebook followers in 1 week, which is pretty impressive. The second thing that you need to realize is that players want to feel exclusive. This could be in terms of VIP groups, exclusive insider news, or perhaps access to a closed beta. Whenever they feel exclusive and they're part of something exclusive, they want to stay and remain in the community. In fact, you could leverage on this as well to set some criteria to your benefit, perhaps such as they have to help X number of people in the community before they could join the VIP group. It's up to your imagination. The third thing that you need to realize is that players want to feel like they are part of something. You could achieve these kind of feelings by potentially gamifying the community so they are part of a movement, or even give them a voice in your game designing process. So I would like to mention that these three kinds are just suggestions. The key idea here is for you to realize that you need to think from the perspective of a potential community member and give them a reason to stay on in your community and engage them. So, once you have planned your community, it looks like you are ready for takeoff. I'm going to share three different tips on how we could help you navigate the early days when you're flying out. First thing, set the tone early. The initial stages will often decide if the community is a toxic or a positive one. Thus, you need to hold the early adopters accountable if negative behavior surfaces. Once the early adopters are well trained, this group of people will help you to enforce and police the academy as well. Second thing is, you need to identify key opinionated leaders within the community. These people are your super members. They can and they will influence how your community reacts to different things. You will want these players to be on your side, as they could be super amazing, such as helping you motivate the community or even pacifying the community if a bug occurs in your game. So if you would like to learn more about identifying KOLs and engaging them, please head over to our GCM Game Community Management Hubs podcast, where I had the privilege of chatting with Maria, a community manager from Nitro Games. In the podcast, she discussed how she identifies and manages a group of dedicated fans whom she calls Hero Squad. I'll be sending this PPT at the end of the presentation, so So you'll be able to have access to other links as well. So the third thing you need to consider when just launched your community is that you need to be able to identify the trends within it and to leverage on them to achieve maximum effect. So I'll give you an example. If you're managing Pokemon community, you'll definitely not be using an obscure Pokemon like Cascoon. Instead, you will spend your time and effort to build something around Pikachu, who is a fan favorite. Although this is an exaggerated example, the key idea here is that you need to know what's hot and what's not inside your community for your engagement to be successful. So, data is a huge part of community. You have a lot of it, especially when you got more activity happening in the community. But how do you actually take all this data and get meaningful insights out of it? The answer is actually to find a way to correlate your in-game metrics with your community data. Why, you may ask? When you rely on your in-game metrics, you are able to get a view on the cohort effects of what's happening in the game. However, if you actually incorporate community sentiment into your in-game metrics, you could suddenly get a glimpse of why you're obtaining such numbers in the first place. And this is really where the magic happens, as you unlock new insights previously unavailable to you. I'll give you two examples of how tying in-game data and community behavior could benefit you as a studio. Firstly, it gives you a much wider understanding of player sentiment. So, imagine you are moderating a game and you have come across numerous comments by players saying that a new monetization strategy for the update sucks. It'll definitely cause you discomfort hearing such comments, and you may even spend additional time and resources investigating how could you resolve this situation to satisfy your gamers. But if you're able to tie their in-game behavior to social media sentiments, you're able to see a bigger picture of what's really happening. So in this case, after doing the correlation between in-game and community, they found that the same group of people who are complaining about the monetization strategy are also the people who are staying in the game for a longer period of time and spending even more money than before the update. So this will suddenly give you an insight that your feedback in your community is not something that could be taken at face value at times. In this case, players could be making comments such as that because they do not want to encourage competitors on spending more, or perhaps they are just feeling guilty from spending so much time and money into the game. Whatever it is, you're sure that it wasn't because of the update that's bad. The second reason why tying in-game and community behavior is important is because it will change conversations internally where community is concerned, and the perception of community could be moved from a cost sink to a revenue center. As a community manager with no access to in-game metrics, the best insight you can probably get is somewhere along the lines of X number of players said that this feature is important, which is why I think it's important. It's not as convincing, and people probably wouldn't take you seriously. But if you're armed with in-game metrics as well, suddenly you could make statements such as X number of players responsible for Y percentage of our revenue, and these players has played for Z number of hours, feels that this feature is important. All of a sudden, your suggestions become very, very valuable, and people will take it seriously. In fact, such insights is not limited only to product decisions, But by making these correlations, you're able to change how marketing does their job, because they're able to relate how community. You also change how community is being viewed, because suddenly your community impacts in-game metrics, and you're able to accurately see if you're actually increasing retention rate, are your players spending more, what do you need to do to improve. When these changes start happening within, the perception of community will go something off from a cost sink to a revenue center. The two scenarios that I described above are not hypothetical situations. In fact, they are real-life situations shared with me when I was moderating this live webinar you see on the screen. If you'd like to learn more about how data could affect your game, I highly recommend you take some time to listen to this webinar. I'm nearing the end of my presentation, and I want to do a quick recap of what we have discussed. So in the first part of my presentation, we have mentioned that community is important because it helps you to get new users to your game, you keep your existing users with your game, and finally gather valuable feedback to improve. We have also shared some tips on starting your own community, and the most important thing is to start with what does success look like. We then discussed some considerations when choosing what platform to use. Regardless of what platform you use, when you're planning to set it up, do always play to human psychology to increase the retention rate of your players. And finally, get your community on track early as you affect and make things easier down the road. Third key discussion we had is how important to have in-game metrics tied with your community data. This is really where the magic happens, and it gives you the bigger picture of what's happening inside the game. More importantly, it also helps you to change the conversation internally and help improve the game in measurable ways. With all this information in mind, I would like to leave you with two parting advice. Number one, it is crucial for you to plan your community efforts, as you may have to have many factors that will require different moving parts in order to be successful. Secondly, you may also want to seriously consider building an in-game community, as this is definitely the most straightforward and efficient method of engaging all your players, while having a method to tie in-game metrics with community behavior. Thank you very much. I've come to the end of my presentation. If you have any questions, please do not hesitate to contact me either via the platform or on LinkedIn as well. I will be sharing a link to our community management, game community management Slack group, for you to meet other community managers and learn from them. I do hope that you can join the community Slack group, and I hope to see you there. Thank you very much for your time, and have great GCAP, everyone. Bye-bye.